The news of the defeat of Poland reverberates round an awestruck world. Erect and proud in all the splendid panoply of war, the victorious warriors pass in review before the admiring leader of Nazi Germany. Hitler had reason to be grateful to these men who had brought him the prestige of a spectacular victory. A victory gained at little cost by a small army with only a few weeks' supplies. Already, he was planning his next conquest, that of France. The thronging crowds cheered, and the voices of those in the high command who had repeatedly warned the one-time corporal that Germany was, as yet, unready for a major conflict, were all of a sudden subdued. His judgment vindicated, Hitler was exultant. He did not realize that Poland would embroil him in exactly the world war he sought to avoid. When, in September, the German troops had marched east, it was to embark on a new and very modern kind of war. Yet, by contemporary standards, their army was largely conventional, much of it heavily dependent on horse-drawn transport. Such up-to-date equipment as the Germans possessed was by no means remarkable. There was nothing unusual about wireless, parachutes, or motorcycles. The best tanks, the Mark III, were not heavily armored. Unescorted, the light Stuka dive bombers were no match for fighters. Comparable military technology was widely available. It was in their understanding of how to exploit this technology to the utmost that the Germans surpassed all others. The invasion of Poland, which immediately drew France and Britain into the war, was a tremendous gamble. Germany's western flank was left virtually unprotected, and even a modest French offensive would have created the gravest problems. But as Hitler had shrewdly calculated, none was forthcoming. The Poles were brave, but the Polish front was hopelessly overextended. The Polish commanders rigidly old-fashioned in their military methods. A succession of swift, deep-searching thrusts soon reduced their armies to impotence. In 4 weeks, it was all over. For the loss of 8,000 dead, the Germans had vanquished an army 100 times that number. The congratulations and medals were well deserved. But beneath some of the smiles lay deep apprehension. For Hitler had let it be known to his high command that he wished to proceed with Plan Yellow, the invasion of France, as soon as feasible, perhaps even within a few weeks. To the relief of his generals, Plan Yellow was postponed, then postponed again. Winter was coming on, and no less than horses, tanks, and aircraft performed best in good weather. In all, the operation was postponed 29 times. During these months of delay, the Western Allies made no attempt to seize the initiative on mainland Europe. Meanwhile, the Germans undertook an intense reappraisal of strategy. Hitler had never been happy with the fairly conventional strategy favored by his high command. The final plan of attack evolved from ideas originally put forward by General Erich von Manstein. A rapid victory was again imperative, as the tottering German economy could not sustain a protracted conflict. Manstein's daring conception hinged on the Ardennes region, regarded by the French as a vast natural defense, impassable to heavy units. Manstein and his brilliant tank commander, Guderian, thought otherwise. They proposed, firstly, a powerful, though basically conventional assault on the Low Countries, luring Allied forces northwards to reinforce the defense. Then, the swing of the sickle, a massive armored push through the Ardennes, followed by a rapid drive to the sea. With their command structure broken and supply lines severed, the Allied armies to the north would quickly disintegrate. It was a high-risk strategy, which gambled heavily on the weakness and incompetence of the enemy. Here, unfortunately, Hitler had good reason for confidence. The victors of 1918 had thereafter seen little need for any fundamental changes in the organization of their land forces. Although France had the largest and best-funded army in Europe, its military philosophy was authoritarian, outmoded, and dangerously complacent. Gallantry was rightly valued, but initiative or imagination was rated far below smartness on parade and well-groomed horses. As in Britain, technological illiteracy was commonplace, even fashionable. Only the occasional officer, such as the young Charles de Gaulle, had the vision to anticipate German tactics. His warning served merely to heighten his unpopularity. Even after the fall of Poland, an official army report concluded that any similar lightning war would be impossible in France. Moreover, France was a deeply divided society, by no means universally committed to the struggle against Hitler. A succession of weak and mediocre governments had eroded public confidence. Many working people were unenthusiastic about what they considered a capitalist war. Sections of the more prosperous classes, their affluent lifestyles under threat, resentfully blamed Britain for having involved France in an unnecessary conflict. Besides this, terrible memories of the slaughter of the First War predisposed both civilians and military to a strictly defensive outlook. By May of 1940, the Germans were ready. The French Premier, Paul Reynaud, was a man far more decisive and courageous than most of his colleagues. But on the eve of invasion, his government fell, and he retained the powers of a caretaker only. Confident that the French would not venture beyond the Maginot Line, the Germans left their main frontier with France only lightly guarded. To the north, Bock's Army Group B was poised for the conventional assault on Belgium. The mass of the German armor was concentrated in Rundstedt's Army Group A further south. French tanks outnumbered the German, and the best of them, such as the Saumur, had superior armor and guns. Yet, like almost all French tanks, it had a one-man turret in which the commander had to observe, give orders, and load and fire his gun unaided. Tasks which, in the German machines, were shared amongst several crew members. Moreover, although belated efforts were made to form rudimentary armored divisions, the French still regarded tanks as little more than mobile pillboxes, to be dispersed thinly and widely. It was thought a massed armored attack could be dealt with by anti-tank guns. These were manufactured in large quantities, but as with the French anti-aircraft guns, many were exported. Few of either were deployed where they were needed. The Germans made no such mistakes. One of the most effective weapons of the war was the high-velocity 88mm gun. Originally designed as an anti-aircraft gun, the Germans had found in Spain that it was no less formidable against tanks. The large French Air Force was under the control of the army, which had a desperately cumbrous command system. At the headquarters of the Allied Supreme Commander, Maurice Gamelin, there was no radio and only one telephone. He was on bad terms with his second in command, General Georges, who used offices some miles away. Their joint staff occupied a third location. Orders took 2 days to reach the front. At the core of Allied strategy was the enormous and strongly garrisoned Maginot Line along the German frontier. It ended near the tip of Luxembourg. Thereafter, the defense relied on the difficult terrain of the Ardennes, the fortress city of Sedan, and the canals and bastions of Dunkirk. Between Dunkirk and Sedan was only a thin line of fortifications. Gamelin expected an attack through neutral Belgium, in which case he would move his forces north to consolidate along the line of the Dyle. Belgium, not industrial North France, would be the main battleground. The British Expeditionary Force under Lord Gort would be part of this movement. Nominally 10 divisions strong, the BEF was woefully ill-trained and under-equipped. Its light infantry tanks, built strictly to specification, mounted a single machine gun. Only the Mark II Matildas, armed with surplus naval two-pounders, could make any impression on enemy armor. The 25-pounder field piece was first rate, but few were available, and the German artillery easily outranged that of the BEF. Like France, Britain had sleepwalked into war. There was a deep disinclination to becoming involved in another continental land war, and for years the small army had been neglected. Slow promotion prospects discouraged the enterprising, whereas in Germany, the Wehrmacht eagerly sought to attract the intelligent. Many of the BEF's troops had been recruited from Britain's undernourished 1.5 million unemployed. Military spending had been concentrated primarily on the Navy, and next to that, on the Air Force, since in Britain, untried theories of strategic bombing had gained wide acceptance. Many of the bombers were slow and vulnerable, but the modern fighter force would one day prove invaluable. Britain had gone to war only reluctantly, and for 8 months, a government of appeasers and incompetence presided over a divided commons and a divided nation. But the mood of the people was hardening, and steadily rising anger at the ineffectual conduct of the war eventually led to the downfall of the lackluster Chamberlain, who was succeeded as Prime Minister on Friday the 10th of May by one of the war's most inspiring leaders, Winston Churchill. It was scarcely too soon. Early that morning, with the code word Danzig, Plan Yellow had been activated. 30 German divisions struck simultaneously at Holland, Belgium, and Luxembourg. Specialist units rapidly secured vital Dutch bridges and airfields. Reichenau's 6th Army moved sharply against the Belgium defenses along the Meuse and the Albert Canal. Fearful of affording Hitler the smallest pretext for invasion, Holland and Belgium had remained rigidly neutral to the last. Now, coordination with the major Allied armies had to be a matter of hasty and imperfect improvisation. By 6:30 that morning, it was clear to the Allied commander-in-chief that the Germans were attacking from the North Sea to the Moselle. Fatefully, Gamelin ordered maneuver Dyle, placing his two best armies north of Namur and leaving his weakest, the 9th, in the south. On the second day, engineer troops landing from a handful of gliders knocked out the vaunted fortress of Ibanimer. The Belgians began a retreat to the River Dyle. Abandoning their laboriously constructed fortifications, the French and British forces lumbered northwards to aid their new allies. Hitler was quickly told. His joy was unbounded. Meanwhile, the massed German columns of the main offensive were forging steadily through the Ardennes. They were sighted by an amazed French reconnaissance pilot. His report and his photographs were ignored. That same Sunday, advanced German formations began to force crossings of the Meuse near Dinan and near Sedan. Guderian and Rommel were in France. At 7 the next morning, there commenced a ferocious 6 hours bombardment of the defenses outside Sedan. The second line French troops displayed surprising resilience, but could not prevent the German buildup gaining momentum. And now, the great trap was sprung. North of Sedan, there stood only Korup's 9th Army, a poorly trained, dispirited force of middle-aged conscripts. Many had just been sent home on agricultural leave. There was no artillery. The French aircraft were destroyed on the ground. Wild rumors abounded, and when the Germans came suddenly upon them, Korup's men had been told neither what to expect nor what to do. With the first shock of battle, the 9th Army collapsed. There was no second line and no reserves. Between Dinan and Sedan, a 50-mile breach had been torn in the French defense. Behind the twin armored spearheads, the elite divisions of the main German offensive crowded over the Meuse. The Allied Supreme Command was still fighting a war in which armies moved no faster than their marching infantry and supply columns. The Germans were working to a different rulebook. Their panzer units carried their own supplies with them. The commander rode just behind the leading wedge of tanks, receiving reports and transmitting orders to all parts of his forces by wireless. For the same tasks, his Allied counterpart was largely dependent on dispatch riders and the disintegrating national telephone network. And if the Allied commander wished to summon infantry support, call up an anti-tank unit, or launch an airstrike, he had to issue a request and await confirmation from another command, often many miles away. In a fluid, fast-changing battle situation, rapid, flexible response was a near impossibility. For the Allies, the consequences were dire. Ahead of the clanking panzers, advancing up to 40 miles a day, the airborne artillery of the dive bombers ranged widely, hitting airfields, fuel dumps, road and rail junctions, and other key targets. Extensive disruption resulted, often accompanied by widespread panic. It was a new, more efficient kind of war. The general commanding the French Air Force did not even know where all his planes were. Many had been put out of the way for safety and remained there throughout the hostilities, forgotten and unused. On the 14th of May, 170 bombers made a belated attempt to destroy the bridges at Sedan, optimistically left intact for the Allied counteroffensive. They met a fierce reception. 85 planes were lost, including 46 from the British Advanced Air Striking Force. Continuing defeat in the air led to French demands that more RAF fighters be committed to the front line. But by the 14th of May, Air Marshal Dowding, concerned that Britain's own air defenses were already seriously weakened, successfully argued against any further transfers. At 6:30 the same evening, a message from the Admiralty was broadcast by the BBC. Private boat owners were asked to register all craft with the Navy's small vessels pool. Having painfully dragged their forces north, the Allied commanders were dismayed to find that the expected new lines of defense scarcely existed. And far sooner than had been foreseen, the Germans were at the dial. Retreat was imperative. On the 15th of May, Holland capitulated. That day, Sedan also fell. the French believed the invaders were making for the capital. Instead, following the lie of the land, Guderian's armor was streaming westwards to the sea. The route of the German advance lay through the great First World War battlefields, names poignant with memories for both sides. The slow-moving columns of the retreating Allied armies offered ideal targets for more airstrikes. To add to other perplexities, the roads were congested with swarms of refugees. It was widely, though mistakenly, believed the Germans must have had the help of infiltrators, and numbers of suspected fifth columnists were arrested. The military had emergency powers of summary execution. Further south, the 9th Army's war diary for the 15th of May read, "No information. Communications cut. Liaison unworkable. Rear areas blocked with convoys and wrecked columns. Petrol trains ablaze. Utter chaos." By the 17th, as the nightmare deepened, the British cabinet were for the first time secretly contemplating an evacuation. In France, Gamelin was replaced by the 73-year-old Maxime Weygand, who was in Syria and took 3 days to assume supreme command. At the same time, the 84-year-old Marshal Pétain was recalled from Spain. In another war, Pétain had been a splendid soldier, and the hero of Verdun held the unshakable confidence of the French. But he was convinced that the war was already lost. Taking leave of Franco, he said, "My country is beaten. I am returning to arrange peace." Yet, among the French, defeatism was far from universal, though many junior officers shared the frustration of the corps commander, who begged his general, "Do anything you like, sir, but at least do something." De Gaulle was now given a makeshift armored division and told to do what he could. His counterattack at Laon was spirited. However, lacking proper support, it achieved little more than annoyance. The Germans, too, had their worries. As the tanks pressed inexorably westwards, Hitler and several among the high command became increasingly nervous about the length of the German lines. Only after a resignation threat was Guderian allowed to continue his impetuous drive to the sea. On the 20th, he reached Abbeville. The last road and rail links to Paris were severed. After 1 day's rest, Guderian struck on towards Boulogne and Calais. The Allied forces in the north were falling back on their last bastion, Dunkirk. Their objectives varied. The Belgians and French saw the port as a supply point and base from which a counteroffensive could be launched, either back north or across into France. Failing that, they would surrender. For the British, Dunkirk would be a transit camp to England, from whence the fight would be continued. They alone would carry hope into achievement. Endeavoring to stiffen French resolve, Churchill made frequent trips across the Channel. On the 20th of May, he ordered Gort, then near Arras, to attempt a counterattack southwards. With 7 divisions tied down on the Scheldt, Gort had only 4 improvised battalions available. The BEF had a mere 16 of its effective Matilda-type tanks remaining, while the French armor could not be organized in time. Air cover was lacking. It was impossible to follow up the remarkable initial success of the small-scale offensive, which convinced a shaken Rommel that he was facing 5 full divisions. Gort was unaware that that afternoon he should have been attending a top-level conference at Ypres, headquarters of the Belgian Army. When he eventually arrived, Weygand had left. The French were convinced that Gort had been late on purpose, and mutual distrust intensified. At Churchill's urging, British troops were still arriving in France. On May the 22nd, the army's very last reserves disembarked at the beleaguered ports of Boulogne and Calais. With the Germans near the coast, the Royal Navy could now intervene directly in the action. And almost the first significant anti-tank fire the Germans experienced was that from the guns of the destroyers, which 2 days later covered the evacuation of those same troops from Boulogne. Though his allies did not yet know it, it was now Gort's overriding object to salvage all he could of the BEF. The shattered Allied forces were more than 50 miles from Dunkirk, pressed hard on both sides by the enemy. But at this point, fortune intervened. On the 23rd of May, in one of the most controversial decisions of the war, Army Group Commander Kurt von Rundstedt ordered all panzer units to stop at the River Ahr. The directive was confirmed next day by Hitler himself. And for 3 invaluable days, the battered, hemmed-in Allies enjoyed a merciful respite. There may have been a number of reasons for the issuing of this halt order. The panzers had been driven long and hard, and up to half were out of commission. Supplies and ammunition were low. Arras had genuinely frightened the German High Command, innately conservative soldiers who could still scarcely believe their own success. In any case, they believed the Allied forces were trapped and could be safely left to Göring's Luftwaffe. Lastly, Hitler may well have wished to ensure that the Wehrmacht did not take sole credit, and held back so that his own favorites, the SS Liebstandarte Adolf Hitler, could share in the glory. After the fall of Calais 3 days later, the halt order was rescinded. Attention switched to the substantial French forces still behind the Somme. The Allied pocket extended along the coast from Gravelines and Ahr up to around Ostend, 50 miles further north, and 70 miles inland to Lille, where a brave stand by 7 divisions of the French First Army, who fought till their ammunition was exhausted, allowed the British a comparatively safe retreat. On the 26th of May, the War Cabinet secretly authorized Operation Dynamo to commence. Of the 200,000 men known to be ashore, it was expected that only 45,000 might be saved. Yet already, since the 20th of May, some 28,000 non-combatant personnel had been taken off. Returning troops were taken aback to find that the British public were still largely uninformed of the continental disasters. Official reports were so contradictory that the Times began printing all 3 communiques, British, French, and German, side by side. In separate incidents, on the 27th and 28th of May, 2 groups of British prisoners of war were slaughtered by their SS captors. It was a new, more brutal kind of war. A vast plume of smoke above the 1,000-year-old port guided the weary soldiers through the swampy and flooded fields back to Dunkirk, where repeated air raids had reduced the 100 acres of docks and 5 miles of quays to heaps of rubble. Inside the town, there was ugly evidence of the effects of defeat and disarray, looting, drunkenness, and rampant indiscipline. In Dover, Admiral Ramsay had not been idle. An evacuation fleet comprising 40 destroyers and an assorted 129 merchant and passenger ships was in readiness. The operation began inauspiciously. Only the outer harbor of the blazing port could be used, and that only at high tide. ships in the narrow approaches were fatally vulnerable to bombardment. It seemed likely that before long, the outer harbor too would be blocked by wrecks. That first Sunday, a mere 7,600 men got aboard the ships. Early next morning, the Allied commanders conferred at Cassel. The defense of the shrinking bridgehead was consolidated. From then on, the flow of soldiers converging on Dunkirk would increase rapidly. But they would be in better order and better disciplined. The French assumed much the greater part of the task of defending the perimeter. They still did not know that the British were under orders to get away. Inevitably, there was trouble. Not intending to leave it for the Germans, the BEF were destroying their equipment. Sometimes, too, they destroyed weapons and transport needed by the French, still intent on a counteroffensive and fighting furiously at the perimeter. Misunderstood orders led to the spiking of 100 desperately needed anti-aircraft guns. The same day, incendiary raids left the town of Dunkirk virtually impassable. 1,000 civilians dead beneath its blackened ruins. Throughout, only the occasional single RAF squadron appeared over Dunkirk, and flying from Kent could not remain long. In fact, Dowding had recognized that the RAF's most effective counter was to intercept the Luftwaffe before and after the beachhead. But the exhausted, angry men on the ground could not know that. Yet the bombing brought unforeseen benefits. Early on, a dense pallor of smoke from burning oil dumps severely interfered with the bombers' aim. And convinced that they had destroyed the harbor and rendered any significant evacuation impossible, Luftwaffe activity slackened off. A period of prevailing bad weather provided a further invaluable respite. From Dover, Ramsay sent over his own officers under the redoubtable Captain W.G. Tennant to coordinate the evacuation. Whilst the harbor was in fact still usable, it was decided to organize the men for embarkation from the beaches as well, where, incidentally, they were also at somewhat less risk from further dive bombing. On account of the shallow sloping seabed, it was impossible for large ships to approach close to the shore. Laboriously, slowly, the men were ferried out half a mile through hazardous tidal currents in whatever small craft were to hand. Intelligent foresight had provided ample supplies of fresh water on the beaches, and after their long ordeal, the mere presence of the Royal Navy steadied and reassured the waiting troops. Nevertheless, when frayed nerves finally cracked, it was often only the officer's pistol that restored order. In the absence of any wireless link, ship-to-shore communications throughout the operation relied on the oldest lamp. The evacuation figures for the second day were encouraging. Nearly 12,000 men taken from the harbor, another 6,000 from the beach. But it was still far, far too slow. Salvation was discovered in the form of the two long moles running out from each side of the harbor. Built principally to service the undersea breakwaters on which they were constructed, these rickety wooden walkways were never intended to have ships moored alongside. The tide ripped through their openwork piles, and the water level rose and fell by 16 feet each day. It was a navigator's nightmare. Yet, starting on the evening of the 27th of May, 200,000 Allied troops eluded captivity by way of the East Mole alone. Throughout Monday, the Belgian army was disintegrating. In the morning of the 28th, King Leopold surrendered without conditions. At Dunkirk, the Luftwaffe was grounded by bad weather for much of the day. The craft from the small vessels pool were now arriving in astonishing variety and proving invaluable. From the 28th of May onward, the numbers evacuated rose dramatically, reaching a remarkable peak of 68,000 on the 31st. However, merely getting aboard ship was no guarantee of ultimate safety. After Norway, the main German battle fleet was no longer a threat, but the E-boats, fast motor torpedo launches, carried a deadly sting. The greatest toll was taken by the harassing air attacks. There were many heroic rescues from sinking ships. During Wednesday, the 29th, four destroyers were put out of action, and it was falsely reported that the harbor was blocked to shipping. Alarmed, the Admiralty recalled all their modern destroyers, leaving Ramsay with only 16 older types. Two precious days were lost before the error was rectified. With understandable French feelings of betrayal and communications still a hopeless muddle, there was much ill feeling between the Allies. Contrary to agreement, it was overwhelmingly the British who were getting on to the ships. Nevertheless, the operation could not have continued without the staunch French defense of the perimeter. The British were relieved in their sector by two French divisions under General de la Laurency, who, declining the offer of places out, fought bravely on till June the 3rd. By the end of the month, the imbalance of British and French evacuated was upsetting Churchill, who at a meeting of the Allied War Council in Paris pledged that the troops of the two nations should leave arm in arm. He also ordered Gorthome to ensure his safety, replacing him with Major General Alexander. Hitherto, although many merchant seamen volunteers had been involved, Operation Dynamo had been run entirely by the Royal Navy and kept strictly secret. The BBC main lunchtime news on the 31st of May was devoted to anti-German riots in Buenos Aires. Then, at 6 o'clock that evening, the British public were given their first inkling of the magnitude of the unfolding disaster. The next day, a cockleshell armada of small boats set out determinedly across the English Channel. For 2 days, they plied the French coast, ferrying men to the larger vessels or foraging for stragglers. These amateur sailors were of undoubted courage. The number of troops they rescued in proportion to the whole was small. The legend which quickly grew up around them was both enduring and, at the time, most necessary. By the 1st of June, the shore and sea line of Dunkirk was littered with the ghastly debris of war. The remaining troops were at the point of utter exhaustion. But the besiegers, too, were worn out, short of water, ammunition, and supplies. Their best artillery had been transferred to reinforce the main German effort. Even so, the Luftwaffe was still present in force. To date, the French had lost 700 aircraft, only 300 of them in combat. That day, the RAF flew only 8 fighter patrols to the beachhead. And starting early in the morning, Goering's pilots enjoyed a notable run of success. By afternoon, 3 destroyers had been sunk and 3 more severely damaged. Ramsay ordered there be no more daylight sailings. Even so, by midnight, the huge total of 65,000 men had been lifted off. The next day, the figure slumped to 26,000. Enough were British for the signal to go out. BEF evacuated. Although the British had come close to methodically deceiving their ally, they did not now intend to abandon the large numbers of French who remained in Dunkirk. Nevertheless, enthusiasm was waning, and to the very end, misunderstandings and confusions soured the Allies' relationship. Over the next 2 days, 50,000 Frenchmen were evacuated. But to the anger of the British seamen, Ramsay's ships sailed with many needlessly empty places. Finally, on the 4th of June, the Germans entered Dunkirk. They would stay for nearly 5 years. France still had 1.5 million men under arms, certainly capable of presenting a formidable challenge. There were many Frenchmen avid to continue the fight. A redoubt in Brittany was contemplated, or, failing that, a large-scale evacuation to North Africa, where strong French forces were already stationed and where hundreds of aircraft were also to hand. After much discussion of these ideas at the highest level, nothing was attempted. On the 5th of June, the Germans put into operation Plan Red, intended to achieve final victory in France. Mist in the Somme Valley assisted Rommel's river crossing. But there had been time to construct a shallow defense only. And before long, the shattered French armies were falling back on the Seine. In the north, the Maginot Line, assaulted from the rear, succumbed ingloriously. Built at a cost of billions of francs, the vast fortification had both encouraged and symbolized the blinkered, hidebound military mentality for which France was now paying a yet dearer price. Meanwhile, changes in the French cabinet had left Renault increasingly isolated, and the defeatists firmly in the ascendant. The enemy now was anyone who wanted to keep on fighting. And those very men whose past cowardice had allowed Hitler to break promises with impunity now sought to know what terms he might vouchsafe for an armistice. They worked for a dubious and shameful peace with far more assiduity than they had ever given to the war against Hitler. As the Battle of France raged on the 10th of June, the French government moved to Tours. There was a mass exodus from the capital, which Weygand decreed should be left undefended. Paris, in all her matchless and still unravished beauty, lay open to the conqueror. There were grim-faced Frenchmen who thought that a few scars might not have been unbecoming that beauty. By this point, Mussolini, anxious for some small portion of the spoils, felt he might safely declare war on France. Advancing from North Italy, his shoddy army was dealt a sharp rebuff. There were still many British and foreign troops in France, and along the Channel coast, further evacuations continued to be mounted. By the end of June, the total reached 500,000 men. As the Germans entered Paris, the French government moved again to Bordeaux. It was there on the 16th that Renault learned that his impassioned appeal to the United States to come into the war had been rejected. For 4 hours, the brave-hearted statesman tried desperately to persuade his cabinet to continue the war from North Africa. They refused. At 10 o'clock that night, Renault resigned, to be succeeded by Pétain, who 6 weeks later threw him in jail. The following day, France's new leader broadcast to the nation. With a broken heart, I tell you that the fighting must cease. De Gaulle, himself apprehensive of arrest, had left for London in a British plane. He carried with him the honor of France. Hitler did not want to seem too harsh with France, which was partitioned. More than ever hopeful of arranging a peace with Britain, he allowed the nominally independent Vichy government to retain control of the powerful and largely intact French fleet. But there was one humiliation Hitler could not omit. The armistice of 1918 by which Germany had so unfairly been compelled to accept sole guilt for the war, had been signed in a railway carriage at Compiègne. Since then, dining car 2419D had been preserved in a museum. For 15 minutes on June the 21st, it was used once more. Later, another tourist visited Paris, and perhaps spared a glance for the statue of the Angel of Victory, which adorns the famous arch. The inconceivable had come to pass. France, la belle France, had fallen. The nation, so long a fount and repository of so much that was best and finest in European civilization, lay in thrall to the barbarian. At the news, a frisson of deep dismay rippled round the world. Germany herself was amazed. The bitter humiliation of Versailles had been at last expunged, national pride triumphantly restored. Yet the marching troops, no less than the jubilant onlookers, were alike under a somber misconception. They thought the war was over and won. They did not realize that their acclaimed leader had further schemes of conquest to hand. The invasion of Britain he would be forced to abandon, the first reverse after so long a train of victories. But on land, Hitler had twice gambled and won. His generals overawed, he was now intent on a third and vastly more hazardous venture. On June the 13th, he had initiated the planning for Barbarossa, the invasion of the Soviet Union. Before too long, the troops would be again marching east on the desperate adventure which would claim millions of German lives and bring the 1,000-year Reich to utter ruination. In stunned and beaten France was felt bitterness, shame, and a sharp sense of betrayal. The cashier de Gaulle in London set about raising a force of free French. Handicapped by a manner naturally aloof and often shading into arrogance, he was at first slighted by the majority of his countrymen. Yet his indomitable spirit would finally prevail. And during the long, dark night of Nazi domination, France would again find her soul. After Dunkirk, Britain had at last found hers. What the evacuation had achieved was to stop a major defeat escalating into irretrievable disaster. Emphatically not a victory, it rapidly passed into legend as such, a legend which provided an invaluable lift to national morale. For after Dunkirk, the nation was at last at one. With the fall of France, the issues were clearer cut. There was even a strange feeling akin to relief that there were no longer any awkward allies to worry about. The British now knew for what they were fighting. They had seen on their newsreels what had happened to Warsaw, to Rotterdam, to Sedan. In place of irresolution was a growing determination that Britain would fight on regardless. The Atlantic U-boats had already claimed the lives of some 9,000 of her merchant seamen. As well as sorrow, there was abiding anger. And it was Churchill, not Hitler, who was attuned to the changed mood of the British people.
And if driven to desperate hazards, he attempts the invasion of the British Isles, as well he may. We shall not flinch from the supreme trial. Lift up your hearts. All will come right. Out of the depths of sorrow and of sacrifice will be born again the glory of mankind.